Okay, so I'm going to try to use the next 10 minutes or next 12 minutes to tell you a little bit about what we are doing with sweat analysis. We are trying to make wearable devices that can analyze sweat on body non-invasively. And the big question really is, what information can we get from sweat? So let me start by giving you a little bit of background about human sweat and why we are interested. I think you all know that it's extremely easy to access human sweat. Just some astonishing numbers. Depending on the temperature and conditions, you can actually sweat up to 14 liters a day. And of course, that is the extreme conditions. Just astonishing amount of liquid that you can actually lose through sweating. Sweat has a larger library of different chemicals, biomarkers, many of which have been extensively studied off-body. We know there are correlations in many cases with different physiological or medical conditions. One interesting fact is that the first mention of sweat in medical context actually goes back to 1606. And the reference is listed here. And back then, the reference was that salty babies often die young. And it was not understood why. And today, we believe that the reference was being made to cystic fibrosis. So the vision that we have is we want to make wearable devices that can analyze sweat on body. And we want to do so for a number of different applications. I categorize them into really two different applications. One is for fitness monitoring, fitness tracking, athletic applications. The other is for clinical applications. And of course, for the first one, as you get the subject to run or exercise, you readily generate sweat and you are putting the body through a physical stress, and at the same time, you are analyzing the sweat that is being generated. In the second case, of course, you cannot get the patients to run for you, so we have a different class of device that we are developing for that, which uses iontophoresis, so we are locally generating sweat while the subject is just sitting still. Now, as we develop these sensors, and I will show you where we are, the key really is for us to start to decode sweat. The big question is, can we start to understand the role of different biomarkers in sweat, the correlations, the lack of correlations in some cases? Can we start to form baselines for different individuals? Can we actually see when individuals deviate from their baseline? And everybody is going to have a different baseline. You can do this because it's so easy to analyze sweat in principle. That's the eventual goal, and we are, of course, really far away from it. Let me just share with you some of the challenges that, that you might face when you try to make wearable devices that are analyzing your sweat. First of all, you're dealing with very small sample volumes. You're dealing with very small amount of liquid. You're dealing with very low concentrations of analytes often. And in analytical chemistry, you know that if your sample volume is low, if your concentration is low, it's extremely difficult to have reliable analytical techniques for concentration measurements. So that is a big challenge for us. And at the same time, we have other issues to worry about. For example, contamination on the skin, depending on what soap you use or shampoo you use. They will have impurities that you have to worry about. We have to make sure that the sensors are reliable. Every sensor has a drift. If you have electrochemical sensors, they will have a drift. And the question is, can we make the drift small enough? Can we make them reliable enough with small device-to-device variation to measure the type of concentrations that we are interested in? And finally, we really have to figure out what sweat is telling us. We have to decode sweat. So let me share with you our approach and where we are. This is a project that we started in my lab about 5 years ago. And we took an engineering approach. We built a system. The system has two components. The device has two components. There are silicon chips that do the signal conditioning, processing, data transmission. There is a second part that is shown in the picture as the white patch. That's the part that is disposable. That's the part that comes in contact with the skin. Think about it as a Band-Aid. You use it once, you dump it, as long as it's cheap enough. Over the years, we have shown that we can measure a number of analytes selectively in sweat from different metabolites, glucose, lactates, to different ions, heavy metals, drugs. One that I'm particularly interested today, that we have an emphasis in my lab, is, for example, L-DOPA. That is a Parkinson's disease medication. Vitamins, skin temperature, and even sweat rate. So we can measure a whole library of analytes today using these wearable patches. Now, what I will just tell you quickly is different analytes give you different information. For example, glucose. We find glucose in sweat not to be very informative. And we have actually a paper that is going to come out. We don't believe that measuring sweat glucose is informative. On the other hand, ions, heavy metals, drugs, vitamins, there is a lot of correlation that we have started to see between the concentrations that are in sweat and the concentrations in blood or the physiological state of the body. Now, once we have these sensors, these are the type of data that we can generate. And I have two different data sets. On the left and right, you basically have two different subjects. That are biking, using different biking powers and biking conditions. And so now what you can see is you can generate vital sign reports as a function of time, heart rate, VO2, VE. You can measure the skin temperature. You can measure glucose, lactate, sodium, potassium, you name it. You can start to collect a big set of data on from one experiment, from one measurement. Another aspect for the technology development was a work that we actually did here with in collaboration with folks at Stanford Cystic Fibrosis Center, Carlos, me, and colleagues, was that we developed a device that not only could analyze sweat, but could also locally generate sweat. And for that, we used a process that is well established. It's iontophoresis. The patch locally generates sweat, and at the same time, will analyze the sweat that is locally induced. So in this case, you're literally sitting down when the sweat is generated and being analyzed. Now, a big aspect of this is, of course, you have to be able to make these sensors very cheap. We want them to be disposable. We want them to be used once, and you just dump it away. You have to make sure that the sensor reliability is good. The variation is small. So for that, we have started to look at mass manufacturing techniques, and one approach that we have shown that works very well for these type of sensors is roll-to-roll processing. It's the same type of processing that is used to print newspapers. You can print sensors on rolls, on webs, that are 100 meter long. In fact, that's what we have done, over just a few minutes time period. So the cost of the sensors are now literally a penny. And surprisingly, at least to my surprise, what we found is that the reliability and reproducibility of these sensors that are produced using this fast technique is actually much better than the ones that we used to make using slower conventional lithography processes. We have gone one step further, and not only now we roll-to-roll print these sensors, but we also roll-to-roll print microfluidics. We can put the sweat into microfluidic channels. There are sensors integrated inside. We can measure sweat rate. We can measure different analytes all at the same time, and this is all through a roll-to-roll process. It's extremely, extremely fast. So now let me share with you three case studies as to how we can use these devices and what are the trends that we are already seeing. And in the interest of time, I'm just choosing three different examples. In the first case, this is the work, again, that we have done with the Cystic Fibrosis Center here at Stanford. We looked at cystic fibrosis. And for cystic fibrosis, the gold standard today for detecting cystic fibrosis is sweat analysis. You look at the chloride ion concentration, and the rule of thumb is if it's lower than 40 millimolar, cystic fibrosis is very unlikely. And if it's more than 60 millimolar, the concentration of chloride ion, then cystic fibrosis is likely to be diagnosed. And today, because genetic testing is so cheap, usually at that stage, they order genetic tests. So we came here and we installed our sensors on patients and also healthy subjects. And clearly what we were able to see was that for the patients, we could monitor higher chloride ion concentration. The one that I'm showing you here, the chloride ion concentration in sweat is about 100 millimolar. For the healthy subjects, we were able to see much lower concentrations, around 20. So these are sensors that work well. They are in some cases, for some of the analytes at least, they are as accurate as the lab-based sensors, almost as accurate as the lab-based sensors, but you get the data immediately. And not only that, you can also get time-resolved measurements. You can actually do dynamic measurements. You can see how the profile changes over time. And that is something that you cannot do if you try to do off-body measurements. Let me give you a second example of what the trend we have seen. And in this case, what we decided to do was, given the fact that we can now print thousands of these sensors, that we can make thousands of them, we can start to not only study many subjects, but for the same subject, we can actually put patches on different parts of the body. So simultaneously, for one subject, for one measurement, one exercise condition, we can actually measure from forehead, forearm, underarm, back. We can measure analyte concentrations. We can measure sweat rate. You can measure a spectrum you can obtain a spectrum of information. Now here, I'm just simplifying the data. I'm just showing you one interesting observation that we made. And what we observed was that by simply measuring the sweat rate at one spot on your body, specifically forearm or forehead, we could actually predict very well how much was the total body loss, weight loss, due to sweating. And why is that important? For dehydration. There is only one definition for dehydration, and that is if you lose 2% body weight by exercise due to sweating, that is the definition of dehydration. There is no other definition. So what these results are implying is that we can simply install these patches on part of the body, and from that we can actually detect the onset of dehydration. Another example, interesting example that we are pushing for is drug analysis. And I mentioned the L-DOPA is the one that we are pushing hard today because the concentration of drug, especially for Parkinson's disease, is particularly important. But of course, the problem is there is a metabolism always taking place. The concentration of drug is never constant. Too little, too high, you're not in the optimal regime. So the question really is, can we use these sensors to measure drug contents in sweat? Can we, from that, then study the drug metabolism rates? And of course, from that, you can think about personalized medication moving forward. We are in the electrical engineering department, so the easiest drug that we could try in our lab before going to clinicians was caffeine. Was basically getting our students to take coffee. So what we did here in this study was that the students took coffee at time zero. They started exercising at 30 minutes. And we measured the concentration of caffeine as a function of time in sweat. And what you see is that the concentration keeps going up. The absorption is taking place. Then the concentration saturates, and then it goes down due to the metabolism. So there is an optimal time that you should take your coffee. That's basically the message from this slide. So I hope I was able to give you an overview of where we are, what we are thinking, what are the challenges and opportunities. And you know, really, I think the key objective for us is to start doing subject studies to be able to decode sweat, to decode the composition of sweat. And we look forward to collaborations. We are looking for collaborations with clinicians and industry. Thank you very much. Thank you.